Thank you very much. Also, welcome from my side. As has been said before, my name is Alan Kadic. I'm the director for Southeast Europe, Bulgaria, Romania, Macedonia, and Moldova. I, on the one hand, like to welcome the Moldovan guests here today, but especially also our foreign friends who took the long way upon them to be with us, not only for today, but also for the next 2 days. I have the big pleasure to moderate today's public panel on educational reforms, and especially educational reforms in Moldova. I think we have a pretty interesting panel. We have two former ministers of education, we have a current minister of education, and we have an advisor to a current minister of education. We have a lot of expertise. Bear with me while I'm introducing the different panelists who I'm one by one would ask to join me for the panel. One, we have Corina Fusu, the current minister of education of the Republic of Moldova. Not only has she been working now for a while as a minister of education, no, she has also been the president in the parliament of the Republic of Moldova of the Committee of Culture, Education, Research, Youth, Sports, and Media. Highly competent for the job she's currently doing. Zoran Kimpiano, the former minister of education of Romania, and also for 2 weeks, prime minister of Romania for the technical government. He is also the, since 2012, rector of the University of Agriculture and Science in Bucharest, and from 2013 on, chairs the rector's conference. Also highly competent today to sit on this panel. Mikkelis, from Estonia. Mikkel, where are you? There you are. Mikkelis is from Estonia. He is advising the Minister of Education of Estonia. What is especially interesting about him, he holds a degree in education and has been working also for advising the Prime Minister. Last but not least, I'm very sorry, I'm very bad with Lithuanian names, so I apologize in advance. Gintaras Steponavičius, member of Parliament, Minister of Education from 2008 to 2012 of Lithuania. Please join me on the stage. While I get comfortable, I would like to briefly introduce you to the setup of today's panel as we have thought about. First, we will have a short introduction by each, short statement by each of the panelists before we go to a nice conversation, I hope. Last but not least, we will take the last half an hour for a discussion also with you, with the audience for some questions and answers. I'm in a very lucky position because Rainer Adam, in his introductory words, have said almost everything I would have liked to say, so I will spare you my repetition and just hand over to Corina Fusu, the Minister of Education of Moldova, to ask her first, what is good education for you? What constitutes good education?
For me personally, a good education means to have the luck to learn in an institution, to be educated in an institution where the teachers are totally dedicated to what they do. In this process, also the parents take active part. I have a personal example that I understood actually quite late. I had the opportunity to, if I can call it opportunity, to teach, to be educated in a Soviet school. And actually, it was a very good school, very strong school. It was in the name of Mr. Kotovsky. It was in the center of Chisinau. And teachers that had made their studies in Sorbonne, in Yash, in Bucharest, in Moscow, were teaching in this institution, also in former, in Leningrad, former Petersburg. And these teachers were of high quality, and they had a very personal approach for each of us pupils. An education, a good education at other levels means that the diploma that a person receives is not just a pride for the family and just another file in the another paper in the file, but this diploma should offer you the opportunity to find a good place in life, a good work. It's a very happy coincidence when the your wish to have a certain profession is also according to what is written in your diploma. So the person must feel comfortable in the society and in the work that he performs. And also in the family, but this is like an ideal situation. We are people who adapt themselves easily, and the only thing that bothers me and that makes me sad is the fact that the parents, it doesn't matter their background, nationality, because in the Republic of Moldova we have different, many nationalities, Ukrainians, Russians, Bulgarians, Gagauz people, Moldovans, Romanian. It doesn't matter which nationality the person is. The parents usually dream their children to have the studies, their higher education studies abroad, and even to obtain the citizen of other countries. Why? Because something is not working in our society. In 25 years of independence, we didn't manage to create institutions, strong institutions, trustable institutions, also pedagogical institutions, because education cannot be performed without outside the system, systems that must be supported, that must be straightened. For example, we can do reforms in the general education system, and I speak here about gymnasiums, lyceums, but we make reforms also in the vocational education. And how this reform take place? The support for the reform in the general education level is offered through a credit by the World Bank. It's a big credit, but it comes as a budgetary support. This was the agreement. We liquidated many institutions, gymnasiums and lyceums, according to the new reform. We also identified the model schools, the best schools where the children should go from the villages where the schools were closed. But unfortunately, we didn't manage to modernize and to rebuild the building of those schools. So only today we are at the stage when we started the reconstruction of two general schools, district schools, and I'm not sure that since 1st of September, until 1st of September, they will be ready to welcome the pupils. And we can say the same not only about the buildings, but about the laboratory and other rooms. Of course, in the ministry, we received and we inherited what we had in the past. I don't want to blame other ministers. This is what we have today, and the only thing I can say that I can assume responsibility for my mandate to take all the actions in order to improve things. For this, I have enough strength. I have a great team of specialists at the Ministry of Education. These days, another expert joined from the European Union, high-level expert, Mr. Funeriu, ex-Minister of Education from Romania. We also have the support of the World Bank. We have financial support of the European Union. We have another small projects financed by the by some embassies, and I hope that together, definitely, we will have success. And these days of discussions and on education subject, for sure, will offer us also solutions. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
So, if I may just summarize, it is apart from the financial aspects, apart from the things that are in the schools, it is especially dedication, ownership, both of parents and teachers. It's a personal approach looking at each child individually. So children, in the end of the day, are able to make use of their own minds. And that is a very Kantian way to say it, because Kant said the best thing, or the way to enlightenment, is not being afraid to make use of your own mind. Having said that, Sorin Campiano, I would like to ask you, why do we need educational reforms at all? Is that something really necessary? And we see it happening or attempted all around the world, all across Europe. Why is it so hard to reform education?
Yeah, thank you for the question. I will speak in Romanian, it's okay.
I take over the idea of Mrs. Fusum. A good education is the education where school students learn how to do something, not where focus is on knowing, but on knowing to do something.
And to know to do, it's essential.
Between to know and to do is essential. In addition, quality education is absolutely necessary and expected by entire society. Is the education where the academic environment is not ruptured from the economic environment. It's education that's based on the realities, on the needs of the society. Quality education also may not be done without quality teaching staff. It's a vicious circle in the higher education. There is complaint that graduates of pre-university education are not sufficiently good when they go to universities. On the other hand, in pre-university education, there is complaint that teachers are not sufficiently good in order to increase the levels of the school students. And this vicious circle has to be broken. It can be broken only by training of teaching staff. It can also be broken just by having available financial resources. Therefore, we need a relationship with the society, we need good teaching staff, and we need financial means. I would continue by saying that education is important for a people, for a nation. Because an educated nation knows how to better care about its healthcare, how to better tend to its security. And maybe the most important, an educated nation knows how to tend to its prosperity. And if we join the two levels, the personal level, without personal education, it's not possible to have. And personal education is a basic concept of liberalism. And the other aspect, which makes it impossible the prosperity of a nation in absence of education, which also is a liberal value, the prosperity of a nation, we could probably realize why we need education. After this long introduction that I considered necessary in order to answer your question, in terms of the reform in education, I've listened to and I congratulate Mr. Professor for the exceptional, and I usually don't use this kind of big words, but it was exceptional study, and knowing at the same time the reluctancy of the society to the word reform, education reform, every minister comes with a new reform in education and with a new mindset. And in Romania as well, thanks God, we used to have 10 ministers of education, recently we've appointed the 11th one in 4 years. And everyone has come with their own ideas, sometimes good, sometimes less good, regarding the reforms. This is why I was telling to you in preparation to the response, yes, a reform is needed. However, knowing the reluctancy of the society and knowing the mistakes committed, I insist that a reform is still necessary. It is necessary in general due to the developments of the society, particularly the technological developments and involvements, which in the past 10 or 15 years has had an extremely rapid rhythm. If we think that 15, 20 years back, what was the level of involvement of new technologies in the schools? And we compare it to today, nowadays, where every school student has their own smartphone, we could realize why we need to have a change that would be in line with the change in the happening in the society. In the past 25 years, both in Moldova and in Romania, we needed a change of the educational system that was mostly, not entirely, based on learning to know, learning in order to know. And I said why it's important to have a difference between know and knowing to do something, and knowing and doing. I would continue by giving an example of the most boasted system at international level. That's the system in Finland. That's a perfect model for the entire Europe. And however, in this period, they want to change it radically. These are the arguments for the need for an educational system reform. Yes, in Romania we need education system reform. And seeing the presentation of Mr. Professor Anatol Grimalski, I am totally convinced, as much as I am allowed, Mr. Minister, to give my opinion that Moldova, this is also needed, the reform in education. But the reform in education is not conducted tomorrow or today. The excellence results can be seen on medium and long term. Reform in education is not done without consulting the civil society. Many of the ideas presented by Mr. Professor overlap on what I believe, needing feedback from the society. We are not able to develop an education system in absence of attention being paid to the responses of the society in relation to the educational system. On the other hand, however, the decisions in education, by knowing the problems and the hypothesis and the objectives and the conclusions, the decision in education may not be taken by the society. Professionals in the education system has to consult deeply the society. And in Romania, we have a project of the Romanian president, an Educated Romania, a project that doesn't want to have a consultation for several months months or 1 year, but on a 3-year term to consultation of the society in order to have the most relevant answers of the society in terms of the need for reform of the education. After we have all this information taken over from the society, they need to represent a solid basis for decision for the professionals in the education area, with the risk of upsetting. I don't want to get into a situation where in education, football, medicine, agriculture, everyone decides that we have professionals in all of these areas, in each of these areas, but decisions need to be made based on the feedback received from the society, because we do not do education just for the sake of education, but we educate as we've started the small world. We educate for the personal development, and we educate for the development of this, for the sake of the development of the society. I won't take over the theory with the development of the society in the context of promotion of Europe, competitive Europe, etc. I'm sure that all of these are known to you, and sometimes we don't provide too much attention to those, but I'm convinced that they are known to you. So the last part of your question, why is it so difficult, the reform of education? Because if it's to give the example of Romania, in Romania, they're directly involved in, and I highlight, or more than 4 million people. That's more than 1/4 of the population of Romania there. And I'm counting that, adding the number of school students, high school education students, teaching staff, and auxiliary staff, and this and non-didactical staff from the schools and universities of Romania. And this is how I get to this number. So the first part of the response is the reform in education is difficult because it involves a number, extremely big number of people. The second part of your question. It's hard to have a reform in education because interacting with so many people, we have a resistance in the mindset of the of most of the directly involved people. First of all, of the people directly involved, but not only them. I've seen the study and I've appreciated it. So you get hit of a dose of, I'm not sure how to replace the word hypocrisy, which exists both among those directly involved and among those, the others. Not frequently had colleagues who said that they're not interested in what students believe or in what employers believe, because they know how to teach, because they've been doing that for 30 years, the same thing, and they don't plan to change anything. Why should they? And I should compare it with the presentation of Mr. Anatol Grimalski. Luckily, not all teachers are broken from the reality. We have very many teachers in Romania and probably in Moldova who do their job as they should with professionals, and I generally avoid giving my personal example, but still, I rely on the fact that Mrs. Minister has told from her personal experience. So for 3 years, I used to be a general director for Romania of a multinational company, a world leader in its area of activity. Therefore, I worked in the real economy. I faced these problems, the students that I was training and which appeared to me at the graduation to be weaker or maybe better or very good or exceptional. And from the position of employer, the same person, by trying to recruit, of course, I didn't go to the weak students, because I'm not a hypocrite to say that. Of course, I was selecting the best and the exceptional students. However, from the position of employer, I was finding that they are not sufficiently prepared for what I expected from them, from my position of employer. employer. This has made me think, because I was one and the same person, students were the same, but the moment was the same because I was trying to recruit them every 2-3 weeks after graduation, where they appeared to me to be very good. We have many colleagues who have chosen a career in education in good faith, who could have chosen to work in real economy. It's wonderful that and I apologize for my personal example, and I could tell you the other side of the story. From the position of a graduate of the best college in Romania, a class of mathematics and physics, I used to have a so big passion for education that I remained in the education system. And there are very many colleagues who did the same, and they need to represent the critical mass that could generate the change. However, I come and acknowledge that if 25 years later, in 2016, I were in the same position as a head of a year, with the possibility to choose between staying in education system or going to work in the economy in a company, and if I see that the difference of salary is from 1 to 10, I apologize, but I'm convinced that I won't never choose the educational system, the career of a teacher. And I gave this example only to ensure you again the fact that quality education without financial resources is impossible. By giving up the academical level, that's just impossible. You probably noticed that I've left this chair for 2 or 3 minutes, and because the new Minister of Education in Romania insists on the subject, on concentrating all the forces in order to convince the government of Romania to provide additional resources so in short, a change of mindsets, teachers, financial resources. Thank you.
Thank you. Order here and there when it comes to education. Just for your information, as I'm on first name base with all of the panelists in my real life, I will also stick to that right now. And I would like Quintanas to ask you, from your position as a politician, as a political leader of your party at the moment, and as a minister of education from 2008 to 2012, why is it so important for liberals to talk about education? Why do liberals do that? And the second one is, in your government, in your position as a minister, what were the key points you were touching upon in order to reform education back home?
Works, does it? Thank you very much. I am pleased to be here in Chisinau. Thank you for inviting me, and I'll try to use these few minutes to share a bit of my experience. While I'll start by saying that I also, Mrs. Fuso, finished Soviet school in 1985. Are we still dreaming about this with kind of memories? Yes, we've met very good teachers there, but the life has changed dramatically here in Moldova, in every corner of the world. And if you take a look, survey of World Economic Forum, the key competences for a successful person in 2020, there is clear list. First, critical thinking. Second, ability to solve complex problems. And third, creativity. I could go on further down, but these are the three key factors. And if we are thinking about what is the purpose of education, go for it. Just make a plan how to make every child heading in that direction. And I think here we come, with, of course, with this heritage we have. I still recall this mentality from old good times, while everything was unified and centralized. And we are often looking for a recipe, which would be a sort of a magic stick for everyone. But in the free societies, it doesn't work. First of all, the needs of pupils are entirely diverse. They are so different that you should take into account not just as a goal to have a unified system for everyone, but for everyone, but with very diverse needs. And in this point, I think a couple of things, I will go in very concrete measures which we introduced while working as a liberal party in government, especially in education. First, more choice for students and parents. I liked in the survey which was presented that parents, of course, they always look for the best option for their kids. And typically, it is also elsewhere, not only perhaps in this region, it is also about private education. And yes, we introduced a financing scheme which allows parents, not only the rich parents, but average parents to choose their children best quality education, be it state gymnasium or private school. And I think it is fair. If you look into a number of countries like Sweden, Netherlands, you would recognize that the choice of parents is being respected. It introduces competition, fair and transparent competition for the finances. And I think I agree that we need resources. But the very important point is that how we allocate the resources, how efficiently the money we have are being used. So in this respect, in Lithuania, we liberals have introduced a voucher system, which now covers four fields. First of all, it is general education. It is in operation in Lithuania from 2000. While myself being a minister, I introduced preschool voucher, again allowing hundreds of new kindergartens, private kindergartens being set up, again with huge diversity of methodologies being taught. Then we introduced higher education reform, introducing financing voucher for students, allowing the voucher go to private universities, and introducing also, which is very healthy for stagnant systems we've been in this region witnessing, that money were going where the choice was. And I think a number of our universities are now at the point where they are about to be closed or to be merged with the stronger universities. And the fourth element in this is after-school activities. From beginning of this year, upon our initiative, while we are now in the opposition, the parliament supported it that every kid is getting 15 euro voucher for whatever kind of activities after the school, and it is outside of the school. And I think, again, from the perspective of kids and parents, it is very good. But I come to another point. It is not only about freedom of choice, but it is also about understanding that we have to seriously look what kind of teachers at all levels we should have. And I agree that teacher plays a crucial role in this field. And I think the figures you again reminded us during the survey is done. Similarly, perhaps with the not too many countries in the world where the teacher's job is among the highly respected. Finland, Singapore are those to be listed out. And again, what we can and should we do that the teacher's job would be great choice for great minds getting out for the kids out of the school. And again, I think a few things to be mentioned. Even without finances, you can do a lot. I know that there are many teachers, school principals here. For example, give more freedom to leave teachers without papers. Just get out all bureaucratic filling papers and all this wasted time. What are principals and teachers simply wasting? hours and hours working with the papers, but not with the children. We did it. We diminished it 50% of all paper load in schools, and I think that was no additional money needed. It was saving the money, and I think we should think about maybe one or another step in that direction. If Mrs. Minister, you call yourself a Minister of Solutions, I would just encourage you to go in that direction, because bureaucracy kills creativity. Bureaucracy kills enthusiasm of the teacher to move with experimentation. And lastly, I would mention another point. Get rid politicians from selecting school principals. In Lithuania, we with difficulties, but we did it. We introduced independent competences evaluation by independent HR professionals, and only after passing this threshold you could go to a municipality school and be a candidate. And most of the political nominees were not passing this threshold. And it was very healthy to get this political incompetence out of the school management. There are many other topics I would like maybe to touch upon, but I know that my 5 minutes gone already. Thank you very much. I'm looking forward to further discussion.
Well, from your applause from the audience, I think you could speak for another 2 hours without a problem. Yeah, but my role as moderator is to avoid that and keep you from it, at least for now, because we will have a question and answer session in the end, and I think there might be one or two questions coming your direction. But indeed, I like that the overall topic of what you've said is choice. Giving students a choice for their life, they can make a choice later on after school. It's giving parents a choice for the school education for their children, giving teachers the choice, the option, the flexibility to actually do what they love, that is teaching. So thank you very much for that. We have Mikkelis as the last speaker on the panel. From Estonia, Mikkel, Estonia is doing quite well in the PISA rankings, number 11 when it comes to science, math, reading, which is extraordinary, especially compared to other countries like, let's say, Germany, which is doing so-so in the PISA ranking here and there. But why I find the Estonian case intriguing is that Estonia has so many similarities with Moldova in terms of the size of population, set of population, a very large Russian-speaking minority. It gained its independence at roughly at the same time. But still, there is such a big difference in the performance in education. Can you walk us through a bit how the perception, how the approach to education has changed in Estonia, and what has changed from your perspective?
Yes, thank you, and good evening, and thank you for the kind invitation to this conference. Well, first of all, I would like to point out that if we're talking about educational reforms, then we must understand that education field or education policy is never isolated from, for example, a country's culture, from a country's history. It's not separated from social politics, from economical politics. And sometimes, if we're doing educational reforms, we might find out that, well, maybe some social reform could also be a very good educational reform, and I will give an example for that afterwards. And second of all, educational reforms and changes, they take time to work. Well, we change something, but we can't never see the results at the next year or after 2 or 3 years. It takes 5 years, 10 years, 20 years. And that means that whatever we change, whatever we do in the education field, we really have to think not one or two, but 3 or 4 times. And we cannot change things every year because, well, if we make a change, wait for a year, okay, nothing happened, then make another change, then nothing changes because we just have to give some time. But about Estonia, education indeed is highly valued in Estonia. We are PISA high performers, and I'm quite happy about it. Well, why is it so? Well, let's look at history. As you know, we were also under Soviet occupation until 1991. But during that occupation, we managed to keep textbooks for children written by Estonian authors. We managed to keep a lot of, Estonian cultural studies, in the teaching program. We managed to study music, foreign languages, and I think this is one of the reasons. But as we're talking about reforms and cornerstones of Estonian education system, well, the cornerstone is basically to provide free, equal education for children living in Estonia, according to their abilities, and also for the children with special needs. And when I'm talking about special needs, I don't only mean that some mental or physical problems. I mean a really smart child is a child with special needs. And we're trying to do our best that in every school, every child gets an education that is right for him or her. And for that, for example, all children in Estonian schools, they can get psychological help if they need it, speech therapy. There are financial support measures for the ones in need. Plus, now we talk about social measures. Child support for the first child, 50 euros. For the second child, 50 euros. And for the third child, 100 euros. So if you have three children, you get 2,000 euros per for your children. So if we compare it to the Estonian salaries, I think it's quite good. Every Estonia basic school children has free school lunch, we have free healthcare, and one more thing, since 2013, we also have free higher education. That means if you're smart enough, if you pass the test, then it doesn't matter if you come from a rich or poor family, you can get a really good education. And if you really don't have money to study or to live, like rent an apartment or something during your studies, then you also get this need-based funding from the state, so you could learn, even if you're not from the rich family. Second of all, and it was said before, teachers. I think good teachers are really the basis of good education. During the last 10 years in Estonia, the teacher's salary has almost doubled, or more than doubled, to be honest. But it's not enough. Our goal is that to year 2019, the teacher's salary would be 120 percentages of Estonian average salary. Because, we want the best of the best of the best to be teachers. We don't want people to become teachers because, I didn't get to law school, I didn't get to study economy. We want people to come to be teachers because, this profession is valued, and here I don't mean only by money, but also is valued in society. Like I said, we're trying to keep good education level in every school in Estonia, in bigger cities, in smaller towns. And one thing that we do to help young teachers to go and work in rural areas and not only in the big cities, we pay them. If a young teacher goes to a rural area, works there for 5 years, he gets approximately 12,000 euros for that, so that he would go and teach. And children in the smaller places also would get a good education. And third of all, what I think we have done correctly is that we have had really good ICT, information communication technology studies in Estonia since the beginning of 90s. We started with a big program in the 90s called the Tiger Leap. Gave computers to the schools, trained teachers how to teach children, and we're continuing it. Like right now, we're thinking, it would be quite fine if Estonian children could do some basic programming from the first grade. Why not? And you know that Estonia is quite a success story in our e-government, ID cards, so on and so forth. So I think it was a good choice. But I guess my time is up for now also, so thank you.
Thank you very much. You all, together with the presentation of the study, have opened up such a wide field of things that could be discussed, but I think that is natural when talking about educational reforms and education in general. One thing, Sorin, that would interest me, as you have been on both sides, you've been a university teacher, you have worked with university teachers, and you have been a minister of education. And there appears to be a certain gap between the teachers and the political life. How can you start bridging that kind of gap?
I think through good knowledge of what is happening inside any university. I would like to explain. In Romania, we have 92 accredited universities, and also this number of the members are in the Council of Deans. And starting with 1 month ago, when we had a start for 2016-2020 mandate, from the Council of the Deans, 10 universities disappeared. So now we have 82, and we are going to go down. The criteria for exclusion are related to the quality of the high education in the institution and the availability to understand, the capacity to understand the importance of the partnership between the socio-economical environment and the universities. Further, in the universities that are going to stay members of the National Council and will stay accredited universities, it is necessary to be understood not only at the level of the management of the institution, of course, in the first place at the level of the management, but also at any other level to be understood, very clearly stipulated to each teacher, explained that the dialogue is the necessary path. And the presentation of real pragmatic elements. It's also necessary to be understood in any university that the internationalization of the activity of the university, be it the universities from Romania or from the Republic of Moldova, is, and I'm publicly declaring it, the only way of development in the context of the economical growth and globalization. If I go even closer to the reality, I will say that this is not the only way to develop, but for some universities is even the only way to survive. But for this, all the managers from the universities must elaborate a curricula adapted to the market needs, but not only to the national market's needs. And also, this should be available in an international language. And this needs effort. Without these things, it is impossible to develop, and many universities are not able even to develop. And these things could not be done without the support, as I said previously, of the teachers. They cannot come, this support could not come from outside. And the support of teachers, you have it depending on the type, on the kind of dialogue that you have with them, on the way that you can bring convincing arguments, and also you can do this having only having financial resources for paying for that efforts. And if you allow me, I will also say something additionally. 5 years ago, We had people in the higher education system in the Republic of Moldova under 35 years old. 30% of them were under 35. Now we have under 15%. So in 5 years, the human resource, the young human resource, is less with like in a half. This means that for the young people, it's this career of professor in a higher education system is not attractive anymore. And many factors are here to play their role. But the financial part is one of the most important of these factors. Maybe they are not the decisive one, the most important, but they are very important. Thank you for your attention.
One thing that came up both in the presentation of the study and also during the discussion on the panel, Mr. Grimalski has said it, the lack of motivation for learning of young people, and that it is considered to be smart if you say, I'm paying for my education, I'm bribing my way to the education. So on the one hand, you have a lack of motivation for learning, because you're the best bribe the way anyway. And on the other hand, you have a lack of value of education that comes with it. Ms. Fusu, do you have any concept of how to bridge this gap of, on the one hand, a lack of motivation, and on the other hand, a lack of value of education in the society?
Of course. Of course, I have solutions. Unfortunately, we spent the last 20-something years without doing it the right things. And I would like to say that the experience of Estonia here is great, because they managed to keep their culture, their traditions, their specifics, local specifics, during this Soviet period, which is crucial. Everything was brought to the knowledge of the little children during that period. When I came to the first grade, I came with a volume of some fairy tales of our national authors. I read it in our national language, and I put this book on the table in the first grade when I went to the school. And the first thing my teacher did, took this book from my table and told me, never again bring this kind of books in the classroom in our school. So the Republic of Moldova had a different situation in that sense, a special situation, maybe a critical situation. We were really, really damaged by the Soviet system. Their main target was to make us lose our identity, forget our language, forget our writers, our great minds. This is why in the last 20 years we were like lost in the woods, because we didn't know our identity. But fortunately, things are getting better in this sense. Anyway, we are still at the stage when we are reminded, we are we just know about our main rulers and our main writers from our history. So we still have a lot of lapses at this chapter. We remember only some of the most important. This is why when I became a minister of education, the first priority for me, and I said publicly about it, was to improve the official state's language teaching, the Romanian language, for those who speak two languages in their families, but also for the majority of the population. And the transformation of the Romanian language from official language in the main communication language in the country, because through our legislation, It is Russian is also one of the main languages in the country. So my position is to raise awareness among the young generation about the values, the real values of our nation. And then I was thinking about how to make this possible, these diplomas that people receive, not to be only just some paper in a file, but also to represent the reality, to represent a document, a certificate that will bring people in a better condition on the labor market. And we have success here because the technical vocational education is not now looked as before as a less prestigious education. It is seen today as the discovery in a child of a vocation, of a talent, and this is a choice that children can make since they are 15, 16 years old. And another priority that I also made for myself to achieve, and I hope also to the academical environment to help us in achieving this, and mainly the Academy of Science, is to make the research, to orient the research towards universities. Unfortunately, in the Republic of Moldova, many of them are just condensed on what they were doing many years before. Till today, the Academy of Science imagines that they are the Ministry of Science and Research, and we want to change this. Some concrete steps we already did in this field. At least the financing for research in the universities, state universities, is done through contests within the Ministry of Education. And another priority, extremely important priority, from my own experience, I can say, before doing this survey that we did, we managed to see that the teachers, or many of the teachers, do not have too much motivation in their work. I thought that we have to think about the project, an action plan, in order to increase the prestige of this profession. Of course, the financial factor has an extraordinary role, extraordinary important role, and me as member of the government cannot promise that the salaries will reach the levels that are now, at least in Romania. What is happening in Estonia is a dream for us, a dream that we hope to come true when we are going to be members of the European Union.
But I have mentioned in my speech, and I would mention again, we are working now on a formula, and I hope this won't be just an illusion. A new formula for funding teaching staff, which will be based on performance. And this new methodology for calculation of the salaries is worked on by an Estonian company with which we had a meeting last week. And the Minister of Education, if we manage to convince some other ministries like Minister of Labor, Minister of Economy, this will be the first ministry which suggests another formula for remuneration, because we have a unique law on remuneration, which is an outdated one. And since I've been in positions in parliament and now in the government, we've been discussing about the fact that this law is not a good one. It's one that's not based on performance. We will be the first ones to focus on performance, and hope we'll manage.
Education. You were discussing the issue of consultancy with consulting with society. How can this consulting with civil society or with society and a demand-driven approach of education look like? What is your liberal answer to something like that?
Can I jump just one topic?
Absolutely.
Mrs. Fusso has just touched upon the science and funding of science.
Please.
I think Estonia and Lithuania has gone through this also, would not call it demolishing Academy of Science in that Soviet meaning of the word, but putting Academy of Science in the right, respectful Western tradition understood organization where Academy of Science is gathering of the best minds and the best achievers in the science. And indeed what we did in Lithuania in a similar way you were thinking, I would just confirm that you should carry on in that direction. We each year gradually were increasing competition-based funding for the science projects, meanwhile diminishing institutional funding. We did it from 2010 until it reached 50-50. Now half of the science money go to maintain buildings, institutions, administrative staff. Another 50% is going just on the peer review basis project financing. And meanwhile, we consolidated science or yes, science institutes in infrastructure. Most of, we had 47 institutes, we integrated them into universities. Because I think we need collaboration between scientists, interdisciplinary speaking as well. And I think it was happening that it allowed our universities to be more visible internationally. It is very important. And now we have, I think, 11 institutes. They were matched among themselves as well. And I think it allows to use the money more efficiently. Similar example about teachers' salaries would go by saying, use your inefficiently used resources in a more proper way. I heard example, you cannot provide quality education in school with 10 pupils. And you just stop thinking that you cannot provide on the countryside quality education and meanwhile pay good salary for the teacher where there are just few pupils. You start thinking more about from the position what we can do for the teachers, but first of all about pupils' sake, because often in such case it is not about pupils' interests. It is just maintaining maybe a one-to-one teacher per pupil ratio, which is not allowing you to use the money in the right way. Again, I come back to the question you have put to me, where we see this consulting with the society and how you get this support. First, you have to open the doors, not the physically the ministry, I mean, but first of all, you just to empower society to have more say. For example, now principals of the schools, when they are already for competition on the municipal level school, pupils, parents, and teachers have 40% of their share while selecting principal. They have a weight and they feel that they matter in decision making. And you should not think about selecting principals, but also using finances. In Lithuania, we allowed 2% of income tax for taxpayers to decide where they would like to be this money allocated, be it sport club, be it kindergarten or something. And with this, it also is educating our parents and also civic grassroots organizations that you get funding, but on the other side, you look where this money are being used. So I think you should not just invite everyone, come with your ideas, it is important, but you just have to give this choice and empower students and parents by this choice.
Thank you very much. So creating So indeed, creating ownership about these kind of topics, both from the side of the ministry and from the side of the parents. Mikkel, one thing you said earlier, and I could not agree more with that, education is a long-term process. Reforms we now put into place might only take effect in 5 to 10 years, or we might only see the effect in 5 to 10 years. And looking at Estonia, where you now are describing you want to have ICT or programming education in, from first grade on, there seems to be consensus, at least amongst the different political groups, not taking into account that the Reform Party has been in power for quite a while. But how do you convince politicians, how do you convince education politicians, and how do you convince education ministers to actually go in one direction and not pull down the steering wheel as soon as a new minister comes, like in Romania, 25 in, or 11 in such a short time?
Well, the good thing is that I think we don't need to convince Estonian politicians that that education is important. I think that basically every politician in Estonia understands that it is important, and education policy is kind of how to say cornerstone for all the other policies. Let's face it, smarter people just make smarter choices, and it doesn't matter if they work in politics, if they are, I don't know, businessmen, entrepreneurs, doesn't really matter. But let's say, well, we haven't, in Estonia, I think at least, we haven't done reforms in a way that there are a couple of politicians thinking that, okay, maybe this would be a good idea. I think that we have done reforms in a way that we have tried to get as many opinions as possible, and to get the best of those opinions. Well, during the 1990s, yes, the times were different than today. We had to make some how to say quick changes and rapid reforms, but in 2016, I think I could say that that even those reforms have worked out pretty good. So first thing, people, politicians, and then people have to realize the importance of education. And after that, you just cannot make those educational decisions from quiet of the cabinet. You have to go out and explain. Like my former boss, Mr. Andrus Ansip, former Prime Minister of Estonia and who is now a member of the European Commission, said that a politician has to explain so much that you are sick of explaining, and if you are sick of explaining, then maybe people will start to understand what you mean, because, well, you just have to talk. I think it's quite good.
Thank you very much. We are now at the point, time-wise, where I would, if there is any desire for question or comments, I would allow those questions and comments. Just one thing I always do, these are two things. Number one, if you have a question or comments, after 1 minute I will cut you off. And the second thing, I would like to remind you what a question is. That's the desire of gaining knowledge, and usually ends with a question mark. So I would like you to keep that into consideration. So if there is any comment or question from the audience, please raise your hand and my colleagues will come to you with a microphone. And if you do, please state your name and...
Alevtina Sidachenko.
Alexander.
I would like to ask a question about actually what Mr. Adam told in his speech. He told about necessity of competition among educational providers. In Ukraine, our corporation grant actually works on educational platform, which is based on 7 pillars. Among them we have teaching by not teachers, but teachers, coaches, and tutors. Management of the educational system by all stakeholders. New content, interactive content, and gamification, etc., etc. And this is a system. And if it comes to private initiative, it's okay. We can have a lot of private systems. But do you think that state can support several education systems in his in the state, let's say?
To whom is this question directed?
Sorry?
To whom is this question directed?
Actually, we have a lot of, we have educational ministers and we have members of government. It's, for example, for Mr. Kimpiano.
We can please repeat more synthetic the question, please. Sorry.
Talking about necessity of competition of different educational platforms. Do you think that state and state bodies are prepared to have this competition among not private initiative, but among, let's say, state-regulated education? If it's private schools, it's okay. Every private school has its own platform. But if we are coming to state schools, is it in perspective, in future perspective, possible to have different platforms?
I think we have all the speakers would like to answer that question.
O să încerc să...
Thank you.
Sintetizez întrebarea dumneavoastră.
Synthesize your question in order for Mr. Timpeanu to be able to more clearly answer. In Moldova, the education in general, the entire educational system, the state or public and the private, is regulated by one law, which is called the Education Code. And all the programs, all the curricula, they are the same, both for the public schools and for the private schools. It's the same, relates to vocational education and to university education, higher education, with the difference that the universities have autonomy and they can get involved with, can have different novelties. And for the rest, we have a unique law for everyone, for all types of educational institutions.
If I got you right, the problem is different in the pre-university and university education. We speak about private and public education. In pre-university education, it was easier to develop competitive educational institutions. But in higher education, in areas like engineering, medicine, which involve big investments in infrastructure, taking into account the specifics both in Romania and in Moldova, there were no private investments before the 90s in these universities. And they can develop much harder in the social, human areas which don't require very solid investments in the infrastructure. But as Mrs. Minister Fusu was saying, starting with we have always had the same regulations for public education and private education. Moreover, based on the fact that mandatory compulsory education is from up to the 10th grade in Romania, starting from last year, we are funding also private pre-university education at the same level with public pre-university education up to the 10th grade. Based on Article 32 of the Constitution of Romania, which says that education, compulsory education is free of charge.
This is, on one hand, a novelty in Romania. On the other hand, this is a big budgetary effort because in the private area, they started to develop schools, very good schools in Romania. And I hope I got your question right. Thank you very much for your question.
I can imagine that a lot of non-traditional teaching methodologies can be and should be widespread in public schools. Yes, curricula is a requirement for every school, be it public or private, but then the way in achieving the end goal is up to the school community to choose. The more freedom and diversity is, the often better needs of children are being met. Just to name you concrete examples, Steiner, Waldorf, Montessori methodologies are being used in public schools in Lithuania. And I salute that. That's perfectly fine. And I think there are Suzuki or Montessori kindergartens or schools as a private entities. But from cooperation between the teachers, from coaching horizontally, learning from each other, a lot of public schools are caught on that. And methodology based on problem solving is more and more becoming a daily business for public, for many good public schools. And I think it's fine. When it comes to universities, we introduced management of universities with external councils, where majority are people from outside. Public universities are run by external councils, where business people, social partners elect rectors, set up strategy, and I think synergy goes from these councils in cooperation between academic communities. So again, I see in management ways also possibilities for different ways of cooperating.
And we would be back then, of course, at the question of certification and assuring similar standards, but that is all manageable, I would assume. We have one comment in here and one comment there in the back.
Pompeanu, and for Mr. Vicius. 4 years from the business environment, I tried to get involved into academical environment, and I draw two conclusions. First one is that if you are not corrupt, you should be almost irrational in order to resist in the system. And the second, by looking at all my teacher colleagues, I understood that the accents are put less on competences than on something else, the competences that the graduates have to have. My question is the following. In the countries where you come from, where and how should we establish the political class to do the change of paradigm from producing students and diplomas to producing competences and skills? How should that happen? Because we have a educated political system which was educated in the same system which Mr. Grimalski and our study have mentioned. Thank you very much. Yes, the study was anyway very abrupt. But your question seems even more not aggressive, but maybe sad. Your statement is: if you are not corrupt, you should be irrational. This is what I remember. But I think we should have more optimism in our approach. I think, and this would give it a more optimistic nature. How can the political factor get involved? First of all, by promoting among the political parties some people with skills in different areas. And here we speak about competences in the educational area, skills in the education. Until not long ago, it appeared to me that this is a good idea to be a professional in your area of activity and not getting politically involved. And I was absolutely convinced of that. I never did politics until like 2 months ago, my personal example, if you wanted. But in order to answer you exactly this question through my personal example, I think that the responsible people from on behalf of those who know different systems, be it education systems, healthcare systems, agriculture system, they should get involved politically in order to be in those positions, to get in those positions from where decisions could be made in conditions of knowledge of the reality and the solutions. Another solution I don't see there, but of course, coming back to the beginning of my answer, if I want to get involved in politics, I'd like to say that I'm not neither corrupt nor irrational. Thank you.
I like to use concrete examples. Just a few to name. First, I agree with Mr. Cempiano, we need more people with experience from private sector. And it should be not a law, but clear red line understanding that we need more and more people in university, in professional training. Without this, there won't be a high motivation, there won't be shining guys and people choosing initiative to become a businessman or successful person. But concrete measures. Lithuania, Estonia, Moldova has huge diaspora. Do you? We do. Have you tried to employ your bright minds who are spending a lot of time now abroad, not only hardworking people with low-skilled labor, but also you have some people who are successful success stories abroad? Make a program. In Lithuania, we said we have two different programs. One program is for visiting professors from foreign universities. Half of them typically to co-finance their trips to our universities to teach months or week are Lithuanian origin. They are coming from United States, Britain, just to give it back to our country, and the state pays that. The same is with scientists. We finance with EU money, again, some postdoc programs, scholarships for the group of scientists to spend half a year in our one or another strongest biotechnologies or ICT companies at universities. And it also works gradually, not in huge numbers, but I think we should start thinking how to not to retain them forever, but at least to get them interested in development of your own country. And I think the politicians, everyone would agree that it's a simple thing at least to start doing step by step.
Thank you very much. We have two questions, one from the lady in the back with the gentleman here, the gentleman there.
Thank you. First of all, I would like to tell you that I am very impressed by this first conference of this type that is being developed here in the Republic of Moldova, organized by the Minister of Education. Secondly, please allow me to introduce myself. My name is Petru Jelescu. I am a PhD university in psychological research and former dean of the pedagogical university from Chisinau, main pedagogical university. In 2009, I introduced at my university the specialty
pedagogy in the primary school, for the primary school, and with the specialty informational technology teachers for the primary school. And this worked, but recently this specialty was excluded from the teaching plans for the future teachers of the beginning classes. Mr. from Estonia mentioned actually this thing that it is very important to the basis of the informatics to be of the informational technologies to be the basis to be created from a very young age, from the primary school. And my question is now to Madam Corina Fusu, our Minister of Education. How do you feel about that? Do you think it's correct to exclude this specialty? And if not, please, can you tell me if we can reestablish in the plan or in the curricula this field of informational technology for the teachers of the beginning classes, of the first classes? Thank you. Including in the curricula of the first class for degrees of the abilities for the informational technology, we consider to be very necessary because we have within the ministry a special department on this field. It is called the Department of E-Transformancy, and we think the example of Estonia a very good example, an example that needs to be followed, because e-governance, among other benefits that is bringing, can reduce considerably the corruption. And we work now at this program e-admission in order to avoid some negative moments. And we also have a project for digital manuals. We don't want to transform the education in a technical tool, because the excessive usage of IT field somehow brings lack of humanity to the education, from my perspective.
If we're talking about children and computers, then we really have to be quite careful about what the children are doing there. And this is why we need a really good teacher training, and we need to assure that if they're in the computer, then most of the time they're studying or doing something useful. Because in Estonia, we have quite a big problem with let's say children health and children moving. World Health Organization says that every child should move actively at least 60 minutes per day. And in Estonia, less than one quarter, less than 20 percentages of children move at least 1 hour a day actively. And this is a big issue. And what we are now doing, we are trying to figure out ways during the school day how children would move more, like those active breaks, like games, physically active games during the classes, and so on and so forth. So. Yes, IT of course is good, but it's also a bit of two-bladed sword that we cannot forget with all the IT that the children also need to move, and like it was said before, children also need this human-to-human communication, which is really, really important.
Thank you. Sorry.
In the spirit of what we have presented till now, if we want to really change something within the educational system, we have to concentrate on competences, on abilities. The informational technology is a tool. I'm not a specialist in educational science to tell you what I think about IT in primary school. But as I mentioned before, this is a tool to
to use in order to improve the educational system. I don't think we have to have informatics separately from anything else, with the exception of the situation of higher education, when we have a specific field related to the IT and communication. But generally, no, I think this should not be divided from other interdisciplinary competences, abilities, skills, because the percentage of the functional analphabetism, lack of basic knowledge, is leading us to a generation of children who do not know how to act from the practical point of view. And my name is Victoria Coroban. I'm representing the community upgrade in education. I have a very specific question for Corina Fusu, and another one for everyone who is in the front of the room. You said that we have a code of education and a curricula that it's unique for all the schools, private, be it private or state. And my question is, if a group of parents and teachers would like at some point to choose to have the same objectives as the curricula is giving, national curricula, but they want to use other methods, for example, to use not classrooms but other classes, not to put a limit of some age for one class, to have mixed children, mixed age children, and so on. Is it possible to organize this in the Republic of Moldova, taking into account the legal framework that we have now in Moldova, and if the Minister of Education is encouraging this kind of initiatives? This is the first question. And the second question.
Hello, my name is Marek Tatala. I'm from Civil Development Forum, a Polish think tank, and I'm also an economist. So my question is about money, and my question is especially to Mr. Steponavičius and Mr. Lees, because you said a lot about successful reforms in your countries and successes in implementation of technologies, also salaries of teachers. My question is whether these reforms happened in the same space in terms of fiscal spending on education, I mean education in relation to GDP, or whether some increase in spending on education was necessary, because I think many liberals can agree that a lot of reforms can be done just because of efficiency gains and improving system within a certain set of resources. So do you think reforms also require more money, or is it possible to do it within the same budget? Thank you.
Thank you very much.
My name is Vlad. I'm from Moldova. I'm a pupil. It's not a question specifically for one of you. I just want to hear your opinion. When you talk about education reform, we should mention the key of these reforms, and the key is satisfying some children needs. And the bad part about it is that sometimes adults forget that in some cases maybe children know better what they need, and they're solving some maybe fake problems instead of some important ones. So how do you feel about it, and how do you try to solve this?
Thank you very much for that question. So first, the question to Corina Fuso about alternative schooling models and the legal framework in the Republic of Moldova.
You sunt. I am the person who appreciates mainly in other people, or I just give a great mark for the freedom of thoughts, because this is offering you the possibility to be creative.
The curricula is the same standard, the standards, the methods can be different, and I think as creative as a teacher can be, he has no legal limits. If to speak about the methods, as long as the objective is the same, the main target being sending to the pupils the final outcomes. We try in our ministry to promote this idea of creativity, but the creativity is coming from a person who is motivated. And first of all, motivated through devotion towards its profession. So a teacher who likes what he's doing will always be creative. We are trying, now we probably can manage this with the help of the German embassy to make some, and also with the help of Japan, to make some reforms in the early learning, early education, which we consider very important. And after an international conference at which we participated, an expert from Japan presented a new type of kindergarten, outside kindergarten, in an open space, using multidimensional space, and it's a kindergarten which is constructed around a green tree. And for me, this kind of education would be the greatest. I mean, creative approaches.
Guitaras. Especially also about the question of money that was raised to you.
Money.
The question about reforms and money. Do you have to spend more to reform, or can you keep it on the same level, or even save money by education reforms?
Okay, but on this non-traditional way of teaching, just complementing to the Mrs. Minister, in Lithuania we have legal act signed by the minister, confirming concept of non-traditional teaching, which allows the room, the space for very different non-governmental methodological approaches. Speaking out of money, let's talk about teacher salaries. I think it is always sensitive to realize that you have to be not populist on that topic. In Lithuania now teachers are getting about 700 euros after taxes. We are now campaigning for October elections, 1,200 euros for teachers with the same money. How comes that? With the same money, we don't say what we need extra money. We just say that we need, ratio 15 pupils per one teacher. Now we have one teacher, 8, 9 pupils. And with the same amount of money, through 4 years, we can come 1,208 euros after taxes, just in the pocket of average teacher. That's the money we said openly. We don't ask anything extra. Yes, we will ask some extra money, and it will be needed for retiring of teachers or requalification them into other fields. But when it comes to the salary basket, yes, it's no additional money are needed, and we are saying it very clearly. And the last thing about teachers and pupils relations. You know what has happened with humanity the best? It is because of curiosity. We have to encourage curiosity of young people from kindergarten. And if we take this point as very important, the relationship between teachers and pupils must change in the direction you have mentioned. There should be more room for discussion. There should be more question time, even crazy questions. But you should not be punished for mistake or a stupid question, even if your question may look silly for the 90% of the rest in your classroom.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, just a very short reply. Of course, it's easier to make reforms if you have money, but I have the
statistics of Estonian Estonian school teacher salary rise, and yes, it was much smaller during the economical crisis, and it was bigger when there was this economical boom. But for example, in Estonia, we have some spaces that we can get money from without asking for more. For example, our basic school network right now is too big. We don't have any more enough students for that. Okay, we can optimize that, and we can take the money from there and put it to a teacher's salary. For example, this could be one of Estonian plans. So, of course, it is easier if you have money, but if you don't, then I think you can figure something else out.
Thank you. Now I would like to close, and as we have surpassed the time that we had originally intended, but only 10 minutes this time, which I'm very proud of, I will not end with a round of closing remarks, because I think we just heard one interesting voice from the audience that you all reacted to. I just want to say two things in that respect. Number one, it is good that we have here a current minister who says that we should not invest in an old system, but rather see how we can improve it and invest in new things. And we have seen that there are so many good practices and best practices out there on this panel here alone, that like we in Bulgaria would say, you do not need to reinvent the hot water or reinvent the wheel or the fire, whatever you say in Moldova, but rather look in good examples of what has happened. And one thing that has happened in the past that has proven successful is giving more freedom to the educational system, giving more freedom to the teachers, to the principals, and involving the students, not giving them the schematics only, but rather tell them, there's a problem, solve it, somehow. And how we do it might be the right way, and we will help you along the way. Having said that, I thank you very much for being with us, for staying with us, for the interesting questions that you had. And now I want to invite you for a glass of wine outside, but please first give a round of applause for our speakers on the panel. Thank you very much.